It's coming, I think. Not yet.
Takes a second.
Ooh, maybe. Wait.
Here it comes. Here it
I
comes.
Think I see it. All right.
Okay.
Praise God.
All right.
Too far behind either.
Okay. Yeah, not too far behind. That's good.
Yeah. Hello, friends.
Now, is the phrase "mash the button" is that a Southern thing or is that a universal?
That's pretty Southern. Because
you said, because
like,
you said, I'm gonna mash the button, and obviously and you're clicking on a button on the computer. But I don't think I've heard many other people say "mash the button."
I'm gonna go ahead and mash the button.
What other people say? Push the button. Push the button.
Push the button. Probably.
Hit click. The button. Click the button, like you said.
How about depress the button?
Depress the button. What's up, Mitch?
Hello, friends.
Yo, Mitch.
We got a bunch of people over there on Facebook. We back. This is, in case y'all didn't know, we Emery.
We got okay. Will double impressed. I'm not sure if I'm saying that right. Matt, what's up, Matt? We got Alina up in here. I think it's Alina or Lee. I can't ever remember which one's which. Teebs. Chat with chat.
Teebs got a feature tonight, Donnie.
Oh, we're on. Oh, yeah, that's right. Teebs does.
Yeah, Teebs got the feature.
Over on Facebook, we have Tyranny Edwards. We got Misty Stone, Cynthia Williams.
Now we're talking.
Ivo Jurovich. How y'all doing?
What's up?
Ooh, this is one of my all-time favorite names. Armando. I love that name, Armando.
That's a great name.
Strong name. Old Jeff.
Old Jeff.
Kayla.
Kelly's up in here.
Love Armando.
How's everybody
doing?
We're
back. Last week, Devin was in my town, and I was in his town. It was very funny. I guess I can tell the world now. I am moving from Charlotte, North Carolina to Champaign, Illinois.
Hot damn.
And it was very funny, Devin. While I was there, Matt, I called Matt before I went and said, should I get my oil change? I just changed that. I say oil. Should I get my oil. Right in the middle? I said oil. And it's oil. Tinfoil. That's what I
you
call it.
You can be in between those two.
I know. But
oil. There's oil.
You put an egg in, if you,
or
an
if oil,
you put an egg,
but you can say in
if
between.
You put an egg in a pot of water and turn on the heat on the top of the stove, what are you doing to it?
Boil.
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 You're going to boil it.
Not boil anyway, and not bowl, boil it. But boil.
Boil.
Boil. It's very simple.
Boil.
Boil it.
Crawdad bowl. So, Devin, I called Matt and said, should I get my oil changed? Oil. And on the way there, light came on. I was like, damn it. Am I doing the bad dad thing where we're driving like 12 hours? I didn't change the oil. It's going to cause some problem, all this stuff. So we stopped. I got it changed. And when I went to pay, I showed them. I said I had to give them my address or something or somehow. He goes, what are you doing all the way up here? I said, well, my wife just got a job. We're moving here. He said, oh, I wish I could move where you were. I don't know why you're coming here for it. And an old lady that wished to God she was smoking with, yeah, I'm trying to get out of here too. I don't want to be here. And I was like, oh, really? Huh? Well, I said, all right. And they go, yeah, I got a 2-year plan. I'm getting out of here. Ain't nothing to do. Ain't nothing to do. If you want to do anything, you got to go somewhere. I was like, what? And it was really funny because these two people at the oil change place made me love Champagne. I was so happy. I was like, oh, yeah.
Okay. That makes you feel like home. It's like,
yeah,
oh, there's
yeah. And
there's
I was like, I know the part of town and what their house looks and the car, everything about these people. I get it. And it's okay. I understand. They aren't ever leaving.
Yeah, I want to know her 2-year plan. I would like to know the details of the plan.
The funniest part was the guy behind the counter goes, 2 years? I wish I could do it that soon. <He's> like, I give everybody a Southern accent. I can't help it. But,
I know.
But I am really excited. But it was funny. Like, I was just at your house, and you were in South Carolina. But Devin's got a hell of a house. But that's one of the things I wanted to start the show with. And I got some questions and see if y'all could help me do this. Okay?
Okay.
We're going to be playing some music and stuff. But we're just warming everybody up, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Got to warm them up.
I'm excited to have a Midwest headquarters. That's going to be nice.
I know. It really is going to be nice.
It's not quite
anyway, all
the
right.
most convenient to the airport, but we'll get that figured out.
All right. Let me ask y'all a question. Okay. So we thought about getting a pod to move, right? But it was really expensive, like $2,500 to $3,000 to fill up a pod and move it, right?
Pods have too many. There's too many types of pods these days. So what do you mean
there's
by
a lot.
Pod? You mean a homeschooling pod? You mean podcast? You
no,
mean
iPod? A moving pod.
Those containers.
There are,
okay.
Yeah, pod is a way overused word all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. In 21st century, it's like one of the most used words. Good Lord.
Alien
coffee pod.
Tons of pods. Pods for the Keurig. You got it.
I know. So I didn't want to do that. U-Haul does one that's a little cheaper, but they're smaller. But I was like, you know, if we get two of them, maybe even three, you know, it'd still be close to $2,000, but right under. But then today we measured it out and it looks way smaller. And then there were some extra fees we didn't know about. I was like, huh, so what are we going to do? We could just go ahead and do the adult thing would be just get three of them, I guess. That would be the cheapest way. And then just fill up all of our house. We sold a ton of stuff. We've gotten rid of so much stuff. But Jess feels a little uncomfortable about it. And I don't think you can put like your lawnmower and stuff in there. Anything, which I guess I could get rid of my lawnmower. But
get rid of it.
So the new plan is I might get a truck and drive to Devin's house. See if Devin will help me unload it at a storage facility.
Yeah.
And then rent a car and just come back. And then that's it. And then Jess has to come early to go to work. Devin said she could stay in his basement, maybe that room in the next room beside him. And then we'll come a little bit later about the day the house closes. I just have to be there for that to sign all the paperwork and all that stuff. So,
yeah,
but Jess has to work that whole first week. So I think that's what I'm going to do. I have to drive 12 hours, unload it, just turn around and come back. But that saves us anywhere from $500 to $1,000, probably at least $1,000. And we were going to have to get rid of our bed. Now we don't. Our mattress, which we want to get rid of, but this way we can, you know, have a mattress as soon as we get there, as opposed to sleeping on air mattresses for a week till you find something and just starting a new job and all that stuff. So I think that's what I'm going to do, Devin. But I don't know.
Build a studio for Are You Listening?
Yep. Yeah, in my attic. I got a killer attic at this house. We're buying a house, and the interest rates are unbelievably, ungodly low, which is so good for us, but it makes me very scared for the world and America. Like, interest rates that low, I go, uh-oh, and then they're printing money. I'm very worried that there's an abundant amount of money in deals right now because it is over. It, meaning everything. It covers everything. You say anything, it is over potential. I hope not. I really hope not, but I get very nervous when it's just, I mean, yeah. It couldn't be a better time financially for me in some ways. Obviously, there's some bad things, but I mean, there's some really good thing. Like, this has been like a breath of fresh air, but I'm really, something good happens and I always think, well, I'm dead or something's horrible.
Yep. You
know,
can't go too good.
Yeah. Oh, I know. I mean, it was really funny. I got worried the other day because I was like, wait a minute. I'm a hypochondriac and I have all these symptoms, all kinds of stuff. But over the last few months, it's always been COVID related. My sore throat, or is this COVID? Did somebody, you know, it's always that. But now I'm moving into the next stage of, oh, that's definitely not a COVID symptom, and I might just be dying. So, like, whatever the symptom is, it might not be COVID-related, but I'm definitely dead. Like, at least COVID you might could live through, right? You got a decent chance of living through it, but the stuff that's going on in my body probably, because the good stuff that's happened, I know whatever's going on in my body right now is probably killing me. And, I'd kill to have COVID. What I got is way worse. In my mind, it's way worse.
Yeah, I'm worried about my death a little bit extra lately. I don't know why, but I had a headache the other morning.
Oh, God.
And I thought, that's weird because I don't get headaches. And then I had the same headache the next morning. And I thought, well, I'm definitely dead.
You're dead.
Because it was right here. I could feel it.
Tumor.
And I could feel blood go. Like, you know, I never get headaches. I could feel like a – and then I had it 2 days in a row, and I was pretty sure I was dead.
I mean, that's what.
Yeah. I didn't die.
Did you take any medicine?
No.
You never do, right? Oh, you don't ever get headaches.
It doesn't. I don't get headaches. And if I do have pain or something, I take medicine. It doesn't help. So I'm just neither one are really in my world.
Now, tell me a little bit more about the headache. Was it like
I can feel
just
blood.
Was it just kind of, so you could feel it pumping, right?
Yeah, over here on behind.
Was it
my
like
left
a
temple.
Sharp pain or just kind of an annoying dull
like
pain in the
boom,
background a little bit?
Boom.
But
boom,
it wasn't sharp happening.
Well, I can
it wasn't
feel
like that.
It was like I said, it's like strong, blood pump.
You can't describe a headache because you don't know what they are.
Well, I could feel the blood pushing through the blood vessel in my head, and I could feel it. I know. And it hurt.
But so. What I'm saying is when I have a headache, I guess it's a migraine, but I've never had them so bad to where they don't go away for days like I've heard people. Right. But I get it. It's like it feels like somebody has a real thin, like one of those ice things, you know, like an ice pick.
Ice pick?
Feels like an ice pick is going into one spot in my brain.
Yikes.
And it hurts like unreal until the medicine. Like, fortunately for me, ibuprofen works. But that's what my headaches feel like. If I don't take ibuprofen soon enough, it gets to that point.
Yeah.
But some people have like a migraines for days and they can't like do stuff.
No, it's not that. But I mean, it's probably a brain tumor because it's
probably.
I'm sure it is. You know, I have slightly different emotional regulation too. So that's if you combine the two, a headache and slightly.
What do you mean? You being emotional?
Well, I think the tumor may have been growing over the last few years, which kind of made
I
see.
But lately, up there, and we'll go ahead and start the stream here. But I for instance, I was doing After the Devil Beats His Wife, and I realized which we have to premiere in a little bit. And I was working on the vocals soloed and loud, and then I started to think. I mean, it started to really affect me, man. Yeah, I was listening to that song and thinking about it, and I was like, really moved. I want to talk about the song tonight. I mean, you know, part of doing these Only a Man songs is a big deal because it's like, I mean, still there's things in our songs that I haven't really thought about. Like, I don't go through the lyrics of the songs. I don't know the lyrics. I didn't know the lyrics to that song, you know? I mean, I know it's about, and I know some of the lyrics, but until I'm really cleaning them up soloed loud with me.
Yeah.
The songs that I produce is like, I think producing for me is a way to actually learn a song. You know, like I have a weird ADD mind that I can't really listen to a song straight through and get it or listen to the lyrics. I'm just jumping from listening to patterns and rhythms and sounds. And so I don't listen straight through a song and get it ever. So for me to ever learn the lyrics, it takes a pass with like this pure focus on the words and lyrics and stuff. So when I'm recording a song of ours that I produce, I always get to spend time with each track soloed forever, like a long time, and I feel like I get it. But Only a Man, I didn't do the vocals on or wasn't, you know, like I. And so to me, it's more foreign, some of the vocals on that one. I never really digested them or processed them, you know. So, but this one, it's freaking crazy. I mean, the lyrics are, I knew what it was about and thought it was good, but now I'm thinking of the imagery of it and the meaning of it and really hearing all the details of the words, and I think it's pretty intense. I think it's a really, really good one. It makes me want to make a real music video for it.
Well, I appreciate that, Matt. For our band, you finally listened to our songs.
It only took you 13 years to listen.
So for the last 13 years, Matt's just been listening to that guitar.
No, it's not that. It's just it goes in my head, and it's like I don't listen straight through, so there's gaps in it or whatever. Yeah. But my mom was the same way. She would always sing songs and walk around the house singing songs, and she'd always sing the lyrics wrong. It would always drive me crazy, but she didn't know them. But she was singing Ace of Base. She'd say, I saw the light. I mean, just like no worry if she really knew it, but she knew the song. I do the same thing. Like I have ideas in my head of what all the lyrics are to the Emery songs,
right?
But that's not what they are. It's just like I have them in my head wrong, you know.
Yeah,
it's a weird. It's weird.
I feel that way sometimes too. All right, we're gonna play a song for the folks here. Or
yeah,
what?
Yeah, yeah. We're back. Anything else to announce? Talk about do this week?
Okay, we're gonna do. We're gonna come back with a top tipper contest this week. So we're a little behind on this one. So I apologize to all the people watching, and to our really, really generous fan in Emeryland named Andrew Maloney. So he gifted. Mm-hmm. This was a few months ago. No, probably more than that. It was months ago. He gifted a couple of everything packages for White Line Fever. Now, a lot of these people watching and here and listening probably have White Line Fever, maybe, but maybe some that don't. So for tonight,
they have the album White Line Fever or the disease?
Probably both.
Okay.
But they have, so apologies for that, but we could probably work out a little bit of a swap if you guys want some different stuff. But it would basically be two everything packages. So you get black vinyl or white, a variant, and then you get hoodie, t-shirt, and the works. So we'll get two of those tonight. I'm still working on shipping the vinyl. There's hundreds of them left, so I'm getting through them. So anyway, that'll be our top tipper contest tonight, top two, and then we can email back and forth and figure out what they're getting and everything. So
that's good. They're $100 packages, huh?
Yes, $100 packages.
So the tips should be start at $100 tonight.
Yeah, I mean, minimum at tips. Least.
we'd be happy to get it for a good day. But yeah, appreciate that to Andrew. Somebody in the chat went to Winthrop here, says Oak and Gasoline. Who's that? Somebody we know?
Oh, he was asking about an old song. What was the side band with Ronnie? Jerry and the Cleavers?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He asked about a song called Going to Seattle.
Yeah, yeah.
So who
going to Seattle?
Yeah,
that was a great song.
So who is Oak and Gasoline? Did we figure that out yet?
I wonder if anybody has those recordings. So Jerry and the Cleavers, that was some of the first recordings I ever did. I recorded that, played bass on it, and the keyboards on it. It was right when I got into keyboards for the first time and got a distortion pedal. And I've been when I recorded that Jerry and the Cleavers thing in '99 was when I thought, oh my gosh, I have some talent. It's the first time I thought I might actually be good at something when I got the keyboard and I remember doing those recordings specifically. They're not good, but I'd love to hear them now.
So it's Corey Gibbons.
I remember him, I think.
I feel like I remember the name.
That's cool.
Awesome. Well, yeah, we don't have a record. I don't think we have a recording of that.
Somebody does somewhere, probably.
Jonathan Reeves went to Winthrop as well and said we played the Pike Party. Who played
it?
Wasn't that
Boondoggles?
No, wasn't that or maybe that was the it's so funny when you think back to playing as a band in college. Like, no one gave two shits at all. Like, could not care about you at all. But which is fine, but I think that was Andy's band, right?
Attic Salt.
Was it Attic Salt that played with Phil Van Campen and we went to it. I remember watching. They played at some frat house, but I don't think it was the Pikes, but I don't know.
Yeah,
that probably was it, but I don't think we did. I don't remember playing that.
We did frat party, amphitheater, Kappa Sigma party, that
Scandals.
Kind of stuff.
Yeah. Jonathan says Scandals. Scandals for you folks was this bar in Rock Hill that you would go to dance at, I guess, and drink beer, but none of us drank beer then. You had to pay $1 to get in, and then you would just go there, and then you would dance, and you just left. We just went there for about an hour and left.
I mean, we did goofball dancing with all the guys and then, just went home.
What a racket they had. It's like the only bar and...
It was so small and terrible.
Yeah, it was terrible, yeah. And it was always a big deal whether or not you were going to pay the cover to go dance, basically.
Right.
Was probably $7
or something. Everybody on campus would ask, hey, you going to Scandals tonight?
You going to Scandals?
I see you at Scandals. All right, see you again.
And it was always Thursday night because everybody left for the weekend. Everybody was gone. Winthrop was dead on the weekends.
All right, so we didn't get any tips at all for the Winthrop stories.
Okay.
And that's after I told you it was a $100 package. So right now, I think somebody left the tip a few minutes ago for like a penny. So as of right now, somebody's going to get the $100 package for a penny. But maybe we got to play some music.
Some music. My God.
All right, so here, maybe we're not going to get a lot of tips. Maybe you don't have any money, but at least think of us like you're walking down the street near a subway platform and there's a guy singing and he's got his guitar case open. At least look at this as an open guitar case at a minimum here is all I'm asking.
I want to be one of those statues that doesn't move. Can I do that?
Yeah.
Then every 5 minutes I do a different pose.
Yeah. I want to be the one that holds himself up. It looks like he's floating. Yeah. And you're like, how does he do it? All right.
What are we going to play then?
Let's do Devin's song first.
Okay, oh, this Devin. Is me. This is me and Teebs.
Yeah.
We got an Emeryland collaborator today.
Yep.
How'd this come about?
Well, so I think Teebs' name is Brian, so I'm going to call him. I like calling him Teebs, though. But he sent this in. This was a couple months ago.
Yeah.
He sent this in. It was a cool acoustic cover. And I think he even redid it because he asked me about a couple chords, and I politely corrected him. He was like, I'm doing it again. So he did it. But and then he it was great. So he sent it in, and then other day I asked him to resend me the video so I could put it together. So, yep.
So Civil Wars?
Civil Wars.
Devin's just singing. Teeb's on, laying it down on the sixth string.
Yep.
Look it out. Let's do it. Here it comes.
Tip.
I remember your face in the mirror. I remember the look in your eyes, the subtlety of your secrets and whispers, telling me that I'm something I'm not. All the silly games you play and walk away with nothing to show. Pull yourself together once again, or else it's all that she wrote. The wars we wage inside our heads, the lies we can't escape. We tasted fear in younger years and buried our mistakes. The weaker ones are left behind, the wounded good as dead. So tell me who you think you are. We'll handle this like men. You think you're tough, then put your money where your mouth is. So afraid of the thought of what you could become. The fight is here and it is more than you had bargained for. Run away, run away. The wars we wage inside our heads, the lies we can't escape. We tasted fear in younger years and buried our mistakes. The weaker ones are left behind, the wounded good as dead. So tell me who you think you are. We'll handle this like men. We've all got civil wars. We've all got civil wars. We've all got civil wars. We fell on black days once again, and still you crawl under my skin. There is no rest, you're always
okay, big right. time, big time.
Yeah,
fire emoji.
That
fire.
Was great. Teebs, thank you very much, Teebs, for that. Teebs. I'll tell you what I really liked about it, the highlights of it. Well, by far the main thing that's great about it is Teebs' facial expression and interpretation energy. Of the energy and song. That's what I liked the absolute most. I thought
he was
that
doing
was
work.
Great. Yeah, he's I love that. And then Devin did a really good version of the screamy thing. It was cool. And then you jumped right into rapping. A full voice and had to really go for it. And then when you got to the very end, we did that real breath. You're always there. You're able to get all the way back down. So there's a bunch of range in what you did, and one solid take there I thought was good.
Well, thanks,
really
Matt.
Good.
You know what's interesting about that song, too, is I think that song has the highest note I've ever sang on it. Yeah, that note.
Is, it's,
there is no rest.
It's D sharp.
Always there. I think that might be the highest song ever.
D sharp.
I've never sang in a song.
Yeah, I don't think you got that anywhere.
It's a D sharp.
Well, yeah, we tuned it down. It'd be a D in the key that we're playing it in. It's a D sharp. You know.
Yeah, I've never sang a D until I was 41. So I decided to save it until my 40s.
Well,
I think probably the highest I've ever sang is middle C.
Well, you know what's crazy, and I was telling you this before, but we got some big competition out there in the music world, and that's that Taylor Swift dropped a surprise album, 16 songs, and all a surprise. So we're over here being productive, but she's being even more productive. And I don't know if anybody's listened yet, but I think it's actually really good. I'm going to find it and show you. I think the trend as I see it now, is not to be big and giant and epic. It's to be small and not sing high, but to even sing low. That Bon Iver sing, Justin Vernon sings on it. He sings so low, you cannot even believe it. Has anybody heard that song? Have y'all listened to it yet?
I just heard it for the first time earlier.
I'm going to play it now and see if it doesn't get us pulled down or whatever. Everybody but check this out. Check out this low note and this type of music. I'm curious what y'all think about this music, y'all, the audience. So to me, this song is insane because it's plain and simple. It's like a dare to be a simple song. It's just like just very simple chords all in plain root position. But it sounds really, it's good. But listen how low he sings. Laughing, but the joke's not funny at all. That's a G flat right there.
And it took you 5 whole minutes to pack us up and leave me with it. Holding all this love out here in the hall.
Yeah, that's a G flat right there, F sharp.
I think I've seen this film before.
I didn't even know that was him because I thought he had a high voice. Have you ever heard him sing low?
Yeah,
not much, no.
I bet it's going to be the new head thing, voice singing low. All right, listen. You hear that? All right, sorry, listen to that low note again. You're not my homeland anymore.
So what am I defending now?
Crash test dummies are going
to
come back
in. Try to sing, listen to that.
What am I defending now?
I can barely sing an octave above that, I think. Toby can sing. You guys can both sing really low, though.
What am I
y'all
defending
got,
now?
I mean, that's pretty close. That's low. Now.
No.
Well, if everything goes to the lower range, then I mean, you guys are in good shape.
That's good. Listen. Yeah.
My time will have arrived.
It's finally arrived.
Can make good music that's the poppiest in the world with playing. I mean, just the most basic chord.
Right.
Well,
that's why I like White Buffalo. It sounds just like White Buffalo singing that song.
Yeah, it is. What is the? I'm curious to. I used to would have thought that song was dumb. Because that's what I'm saying. It's part of being emotional for me. It's like I'm connecting with it somehow. But I used to would have thought, what a dumb song. It's a stupid piano part, 3 basic chords, and they're just singing plain. There's nothing. It's not, you know. So, but now I feel when I'm really listening to it, I kind of connect with it. So how do you think it is? What really is working about that? That you can be simple, plain, quiet, you know.
Well, I think
and
it's a combination.
It works.
I think it's a combination of things. So what I'll say is, first of all, I think it's the age of the listener. So I think with us, like we went through the phase of early artist, I'll call it early artist syndrome, you know, where you have everything has to be a little bit complex, a little bit has to draw you in with some complicated type sound or progression or something that's more, has more to it. And then you kind of get to the point in your musical brain, whatever you want to call it, to where you realize that that's not really what you're looking for. You know what I mean? You kind of realize that it's more than that. So then you kind of get to the point in your career that the most simple things you can hear are some of the most attractive things that you enjoy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
If they're really actually really good. So what is actually really good about
this?
But
if you had heard this song when you were 22 or 24, you would not have liked it.
True.
Right.
Or 24. Now, and also, I think it's the current state of music, like Billie Eilish and all that stuff that's real intimate, real soft, and not even all that complex. It's just some kind of instrumentation. So I think it's a combo of those two things.
But this is kind of a trendsetter, you know, in that way. Like people are going to be trying to get quiet and singing low. I think that'll be what you'll see a lot more of. I mean, you already are, but I mean, like Taylor Swift, I thought does pop anthems that kids like or something. You know,
right.
But she's in a mood. Somebody said it's like Phoebe from Friends finally wrote an album. But anyway, pretty good. But I'm just saying, what separates a root position C, G, E minor piano part and a melody? What are they doing that is holds your attention from your point of view? What takes it to the next level? Where is it their projection of something or the mood they have? Like, what is the ethereal part of it? How would you describe that?
It's a lot of it is the, it feels like it's vulnerable because the voice is right there and it is low and you don't normally hear that. And the music is so simple that the voice has to really, it really stands out. There's not a lot of other stuff to listen to. So the fact that you would do that and then a male and a female voice together is always neat.
It's usually a confidence thing though. You know?
I think it's a little bit of confidence. Yeah.
That they can pull off even something simple and just,
but it's how you feel when you're sad. That's
right.
Yeah. You know, that's what you would, you wouldn't sing like, whatever a emo guy with super tight girl pants on or whatever. You wouldn't do, you, I mean, I guess maybe some people do, but I'm saying that's the kind of thing where you're walking around and you're just like bummed out. And
yeah, but and a less good songwriter or performer does a song like that and it's terrible. Like,
well, yes,
you know. Sure. But I mean, you had to be a good at music.
I mean, it kind of reminds me a little bit when I first heard, the brand new album, The Devil and God.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So the first song I heard was Losing All Your Friends. It was real kind of low and it was real quiet. I could barely even understand what he was saying. Losing and the drinking and the dry. You know, it's so And I was like, wait a second, what is this? And then obviously there's more dynamics to that. But it drew me in. Like the first thing was like, whoa, what's he even saying? I can't even hear him. It's so low. You know what I mean? So I think it's a little bit of that drawing you in, and then you're in there, and it's, you know what I mean, it's just pulling you in. That's what the whole, I don't know, that's just the new thing, because that's what Billie Eilish does. I mean, I didn't think I would like her. I remember hearing either. About her and I was like, I'm not gonna listen to this 16-year-old girl do this. This is silly. But then I listen to it in headphones, I'm like, whoa, this is crazy.
It's made for AirPods obviously, and there's something weird about her in that. To me, it proves that proves even more to me that AI is going to be able to do music, because she doesn't actually have life experience. Like, you think Adele is all can do all this stuff because she's been hurt and she's lived and she's, and when she means it, when she feels it and it's so emotive, and then this 17-year-old girl that just copies that sound from an early age, like, you know, just gets in, like, is mimicking and then gets there somehow, like the LeBron James or something. It's like, oh, but it's not like a lived experience thing, which means if a kid can do it, a computer can do it. Once they figure out what it is, you know. So that's kind of where my head's at with the whole thing. But thank you for indulging me on that side note. How about some more of our music?
Sure. Yeah.
What you want to do?
Kobe, you did a cover song this week.
I did a cover song.
Yeah, we'll do this and that.
We want to do that, or we want to do, let's do it. I was going to say, too, though, like with Teebs, we are open to you folks out there, you musicians, whatever instrument you play. If y'all want to do an instrumental, it's pretty fun for us to sing along with it. So if you want to, anybody out there that wants to do that, I've done one. Devin's done one now. Hell, Matt can do one.
Hell.
Matt, you can sing low. Like
Bon Iver. The first verse if you want to.
Bon Iver. I don't know what his name is. Bon Iver?
Bon Iver? Bon Iver?
Bon Iver. Well, this week I was messing around. I was sitting on my couch and I started playing this song and I was like, man, I'm good at figuring songs out. But then I failed real bad at it. That, you know, I can get a couple chords, you know, that's my skill. I'll pick up a guitar, play, you know, two chords of a song, sing it for a second. Everybody thinks I know it and I don't know shit. So, this one is Bohemian Rhapsody and I was just singing it and I was like, oh, this is fun. But I was like, I can't do everything. Like, you know, like they do, obviously, with this acoustic guitar. So I kind of just wanted to do a fun version that I liked if I was just sitting around trying to play the whole song on an acoustic guitar. So it's a little experimental, a little improv almost. I played one note that I wish I wouldn't have played. I played a C major instead of an A minor, but I think it still worked. And so it was just kind of fun. I was like, I'm just going to play this all the way through and see what happens. And so this is what happened. This would be like if you were just hanging out on our bus and I just picked up the guitar and somebody said, hey, play that Bohemian Rhapsody.
You know that
all.
Like,
let me see. I won't be able to do it. You know, baby, I probably want, is this the real? And you just start. So, and I did it lower. I did it lower too, which I thought was kind of fun. So,
nice.
Bon Iver ain't the only one.
Bon Iver. Ain't the only one.
Bon Iver ain't the only one that can sing low.
Now, Devin Toby sing a Murrell D sharp. Sing Toby sing a low D sharp.
Ooh, I can't wait to hear that.
Here we go.
Here we go.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. I'm just a poor boy, I need no sympathy, because it's easy come, easy go, little high, little low. Any way the wind blows doesn't really matter to me, to me. Mama just killed a man, put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life had just begun, and now I've gone and thrown it all away. Mama, didn't mean to make you cry. If I'm not back again this time tomorrow, carry on, carry on, 'cause it doesn't really matter. Too late, my time has come. Send shivers down my spine, body's aching all the time. Goodbye, everybody, I've gotta go. Gotta leave this world behind and face the truth. Mama, I don't wanna die. I sometimes wish I'd never been born at all. I see a little silhouette of a man, Scaramouche, Scaramouche. You do the fandango, thunderbolts and lightning, very, very frightening me. Galileo, Galileo, Galileo Figaro, Magnifico. Oh, I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me. He's just a poor boy from a poor family, spare him his life from this monstrosity. Easy come, easy go, will you let me go? It's little I know, we will not let you go. It's little I know, we will not let you go. It's little we will not let you go. No, 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 never let you go. Oh, mamma mia, mamma mia, Beelzebub, the devil put aside for me, aside for me. So you think you can stone me and spit in my, you think you can love me, leave me to die. Oh, baby, can't do this to me. Just gotta get out, just gotta get out, just gotta get right out of here. Nothing really matters, nothing really matters, nothing really matters to me. Anyway, the wind blows.
Wow.
All right.
one pisses me off.
Why?
Well, it's really good. I'm jealous.
Yeah, that was great.
That causes
that, awesome.
That actually gives me jealousy for some reasons, some specific reasons in this case. But I am always jealous of people that can. I mean, the truth is, I do music so that I get close to that expressive stuff. But I think it's probably everybody's dream to be able to be that expressive, you know? And some people just can't do it. That's why I think you guys can do something with simple stuff like Taylor Swift, and somehow, I mean, it's kind of irritating, I'm saying, for the rest of us is the way we feel about that. You know what I mean?
I do, but I think everybody, maybe it's not, maybe it's just that we will go there. Maybe, you know what I mean?
It's hard. I've been studying it my whole life. That's what I'm saying. I study all the elements of music all the time and think about it and have for 20 years. And I'm starting to get closer to understanding those higher level things. And I still one day will think I'll be able to do something expressive and it's not a joke. But I mean, that's probably still a long way off.
Well,
I think one day I'll do it.
I mean, most people have heard me say this. Freddie Mercury's my favorite singer of all time. I love Queen. I think they're amazing. That song. Of course, never had heard. I'd always heard all the other songs. That one never played on the radio. My dad liked Queen, so I think he might even had a tape of Queen, you know. And I heard all the other hits, but that one is a long song. They never really played on the radio until Wayne's World movie, and then Wayne's World movie just blew that song out of the water. And everybody's like, "Oh, this is amazing! This is." But the whole thing about Queen that is so wonderful is that song starts out really sad. It's still poppy.
Oh, yeah.
And catchy, but I mean, it's really sad. I mean, it's talking about I killed a man and now my life is over, which I've always felt. I know this sounds crazy, but I have always felt so bad for criminals, young criminals. Like, I just hate it that, like, they made a mistake and it's a bad one, but that's it. And so that's always resonated with me. Those lyrics just resonated. Like, your life is over. Of course, you ended somebody else's life, but your life is two lives now. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what you do. Even if you might not could recover even if you didn't go to jail or whatever, you know. But anyway, I think the neat thing about that is the song is so, it feels heavy and sad. And then it goes to the most hilarious, wild, operatic thing that you could do. And they're singing Bismillah, you know, I mean, Scaramouche, Scaramouche, can you do the fandango? I mean, everything about it is like just so neat. Like it's awesome. It takes you through this whole range of emotions to, you know, and that's what I love about them. There's sad lyrics, but it seems like, I've always said that, like, don't stop me now. It's really the lyrics. If you read the lyrics, it seems super sad. It seems like a really down, but the song is amazing and upbeat. And you want to dance and all this stuff. And so that's one of the things that I'm not scared to sing Bismillah. No, we want in a different way. I'm not scared to look silly or doing that in a serious way or make the song slow or anything. You know, that's one thing that I think Devin and I probably have is that there's nothing off limits. There's nothing that would make me feel like a dummy for singing, really. Mm-hmm. I'll sing any, you know, what the whatever song. There's plenty of songs with silly lyrics. I'll sing it right now, and I bet I can make it good. That's a challenge. That's fun. And the lyrics might not be as bad as you think. It's just easy to say, you know, Nickelback sucks. But you could play it. I could. In fact, that's probably a challenge I should do.
I should probably do a Nickelback
song next week and just make it badass.
I was thinking you should do next week the same song idea of it, of what you're saying about somebody dying, and you is the I Hung My Head. You should do that one.
I Hung My Head. Because,
he kills the guy, and now he knows it's the same thing you just said.
Oh, yeah.
That's a Sting song that Johnny Cash did.
Yeah, but I know. It's crazy.
Let's check that. That might be a good cover. But, yeah, I love the idea of trying to make a Nickelback song. What would be the definition of the challenge? Play a Nickelback song and make you really feel.
Yeah, you have to play a song that everybody it's a from a band that everybody kind of shits on, and then you just play it and you go, well, that actually wasn't that bad. You know what I mean? Like, it just the way people interpret songs really can open up a song. That's what I'm saying. Because
comes from like a character. Like, he's a character, and you can inhabit a different character and take their song to it. But you have to pick just the right character and pull it off. But I bet you can do
it. Maybe that should be our challenge for next week.
Nickelback.
What are you gonna do?
What else?
Let's say we do two covers.
Okay.
And we have to both take kind of funny covers that are made fun of and make them good.
Or you can take a happy song and make it sad. Does it have to be made fun of or just happy or something?
I guess either or.
Well, you could take a happy song and make it like where you're like you feel it.
Could you play Love Shack like, and make it make me cry?
That's a good challenge.
Love Shack is not a joke. It is my favorite song. But right. If you could take that and make it sad, that'd be kind of cool.
That'd be kind of hard, though. Be,
okay. Or you don't want a challenge?
I'll take it.
Tin roof rusted.
There's a lot of funny stuff in there if you could pull it off sad and figure out how to make it dramatic. I'd be way into it. Yeah. I'll think about that, too. I love that. And then the other reason that makes me mad that you did this song is this should make everybody mad. I was planning a surprise. I was going to – when we were doing that show in April that got canceled in Seattle, we were doing a show that's kind of similar to some of the stuff here, but a full band show that we were working really hard on. And I wanted to do Bohemian Rhapsody and involve have the crowd sing and us play the whole song. And I didn't even tell you two because I wanted to prove that we could learn it and know it so it wasn't like – and then just show it to you. So I told Chris to learn the guitar part and solo, and I learned the piano and stuff on the song. So then I thought about that for a while, and then we didn't get to do it. And then here you go covering it, and I didn't even get to play the piano part that I learned for the cover.
Well, we can do it again. We've been talking about doing a covers album anyway. We're doing a million things here with music wise, but I would love to do a covers album anyway. That'd be so fun. We never as a band, we hardly ever played any covers live or anything. I mean, we know them and we listen to music a ton, but we just never ended up getting covers to fit in our set that much. But it always felt weird to play that.
But I learned that on the piano and try to sing it sometimes and try to make it feel some way, and I can't do it. But I know all the, like, you just played the notes simple, but I know what all the notes are in the piano part, and I still can't make it sound right, sound good, you know? So, like, I can play the piano part. You hear that?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I got it. I mean, what? When you're singing, though, so you're a relatively new singer.
I can't even do it. I mean, I can't. I just
Are a good singer. Like, I'll say this honestly right now. You've improved your singing probably, I don't know, 100%.
I'm sure, yeah.
In the past 10 years, right?
Yep.
Since, like, Matt and Toby, you guys put an album out, you kind of sang a little bit, and then more and more. And now, like on some of the recordings where you sing a part, or what was the song, what Christmas song we
People
did?
People
like
the
sang.
Christmas song, yeah.
You sang is great.
But that was a character that I could, you know, I could do that.
I know.
But it was just because it was a character. But so, I mean, I can sing some notes, but I can't make anybody
really
feel anything.
Right. You've always had really good pitch, and then you kind of work through like getting to understand like how to get your timbre and everything kind of just so it's not so robotic, you know, in a sense.
It still just sounds me talking, though, is what everybody says.
Well, kind of. But then the next step is like figure out how to do dynamic styles and stuff like that. I mean, it's just you just keep working through
There's it. There's a bunch of layers. That's what I'm saying, but people that can do it well could just intuitively had all that even at the very beginning, like the – So to me, I had to build all the layers one at a time until eventually I'll have dynamics and expressiveness and tone and face or what. I don't know how you do it, but
you might be the next Frank Sinatra.
Ten more years, I might be able to really do a song by myself one day.
50 years old.
Yeah. But I love that. I mean, the way you're playing the guitar on that is quiet in that tinkly little barely playing. Mm-hmm. That's what I love the most, but I struggle to do it. But I really love it. So good work on that.
I just looked up the lyrics to Love Shack, and it would be funny to do that one. That would be.
Sign says.
Bang, bang, bang on the door, baby. Yeah. Knock a little louder. Bang, bang, bang on the door.
Your what? Tin roof. Rusted.
Love Shack, baby, Love Shack. Love Shack, baby, Love Shack.
It'll be hard.
Oh, baby, that's where it's at. That might be a challenge accepted. We'll figure these out. Yeah, okay. Definitely I'll do a couple.
Are we doing news tonight?
You want to do news or you want to keep moving with music?
We'll finish with a song if you want to do. We got one. We don't have four songs now. We have three. So we're going to do news.
Three, yeah.
Now would be the time.
Okay, I got a little bit of news. It's not the best. Do I have to put on my outfits as I'm moving? Can I just stay in my regular clothes tonight?
Yeah, you can just stay in your regular clothes.
Okay. I don't even have any. Do I have any kick-ass music coming on?
Yeah, hold on. I can give you some kick-ass music.
Oh, Lord. I feel like it's already... Just don't play that Bohemian Rhapsody piano thing. It's damn news.
Back in Black.
All right.
Okay, go
All
ahead.
All right. Welcome to the damn news, everybody. It's been a few weeks. Here we go. We're back in it. I kept looking up news and stuff, but it's so funny. Like, I've done this before, but the life of a newsman, it's tough for these folks out there. Like, one of the news this week was Jason Bateman, not only a good dad, a funny dad. I was like, what is it like in this day and age? Like, they have to write, like, there's so much happening and not happening that you just have to do stuff like that. Like, somebody goes, oh, you know what? I got to write something about how cool Jason Bateman is. And people read it because it's Jason Bateman and they like him. So you just pick somebody that's, you like and is famous. But yeah. So that's why this first, I was going to see if y'all recognize this first person that I got on the news tonight. Y'all know who that
Oliver
is?
Oliver Tree.
Oh, yeah. He has a new album that just came out.
Oh.
Yeah, that's right. This comes from NTV News.
Didn't he delay his album because of COVID, right?
Yes, he did. The name of the album is Ugly is Beautiful. And this is Oliver Tree's new album. But is it his last? It's his very first full length, but is it his last? Yeah, it's a strange thing to say for an artist who's ostensibly just getting started to say this is the end of their music career. But Tree says, I'm just ready to drop all the bullshit and just get to be the real guy. Make the real art, he said in a Zoom call with MTV News. He was in his plastic bubble. Mm-hmm. He does his plastic bubble. He's dressed in his typical uniform, signature bowl cut, his mother's ski jacket, massive Jenko flares, and red sunglasses. But he says he just feels over it. And the reporter here can't quite tell if he's just being a trickster or what, because for those of you that don't know Oliver Tree, he makes these crazy videos. The music's actually great.
Amazing.
I actually really love his music, yeah. But he does just wild. He has this wild persona, and I think the whole thing is basically not to be like a good looking, like the music he's doing, the DJ pop that field is usually like good looking people. And he's trying to just do the opposite, like look goofy, not be the cool person and all of that stuff. I mean, he's done so many different things. He does the online antics on the social media, like running around with flamethrowers, giving himself a quarantine cut with oversized scissors, defiantly shattering a bong and declaring that smoking weed's for fools. He does all kinds of stuff. But he went on to say, I'm just excited to go and step behind the camera and be focused in there. The only reason I'm in any of these videos is it's the means to an end. It's the only way I can get the funding to make this shit. So I've only been the puppet because that was the only way I could get the funding. But Oliver Tree is a puppet master.
Awesome.
And so the truth is he's going to go into puppet master phase. He's going to be working on and orchestrating from behind the curtain. So he's making this, it's kind of almost similar to this, what the author of this article says. It's kind of like a WWE wrestler. It's a persona, and he's putting it on, and he wants to say it's the end because that just gets you more.
Knows,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But like you said, COVID canceled this debut album, so finally he's putting it out. And but he's saying that it's the end. But overall, the big thing is it's probably not the end. That's probably just a show. But that's what I wanted to talk about tonight. In this day and age, you have to really do more, right? Like I think that's the thing. Like, lots of people, you have the most access you've ever had in life to being able to create music, right? Mm-hmm. But there are artists now. Matt, you just sent us the artist. What was the...
I don't know how to pronounce it.
Yeah, I don't know how to say it either.
No, I don't know how to pronounce it. Toby. His name's Toby.
Yeah, his name's
Tobin,
Toby.
Isn't it?
Toby. It's T-O-B-E, like, T-O-B-E. And then it's an African name or something. I don't know.
It's great. But they're doing great video work. And it's... more real or absurd or wild. Like Oliver Tree is just doing something where you kind of got to watch it and it goes along with it. And it's like, it was funny when I was in college, I was in a band with two guys from Australia and their favorite band was Queen. And they said, they would just talk about how Queen on stage was just it, Queen was the perfect name because the regalia and the pomp and circumstance and everything about it, and it set them apart. And it was like they were bigger than just a band. And I was like, and that's kind of the way I've always felt, maybe too, about like Pink Floyd in a way. Like when I was listening to The Wall the other day, I was like, man, it's just so much, and I want something to go along with it visually. You know, you want something to go along with the music visually. It that fits and explores a whole other side of what the artist was doing with the music. And so Oliver Tree's doing that, and that's what I was thinking. That's probably the next stage of music is it will be so integrated. MTV touched on it in the 80s with MTV Music. It was videos, right? Mm-hmm. But that died out because it wasn't as authentic to the music, I think. I think people got over it too quickly, but now that's coming back. You know what I mean?
That's a good way to look at it because that was like a preview of something, but it's kind of stupid because the music was like you would just get video directors and then they would do stuff to your music and make all these videos that weren't what the music wasn't for it. And we're finally getting to the point where the music and the visual can be created simultaneously and where it's a primary thing. And that's what I really think. Jerry, please get out of here. Jerry, get out! And close the door, please. Sorry. The Oliver Tree is not a joke, though, to me. Like he's funny.
Yeah, it's not.
But I think funny just sets up the profoundness of it. The silliness makes it really a surprise when you realize how good and the music in itself is.
Right.
And so then it seems like the music is, and this is the way I feel. I don't mean this just in a negative way, but I feel like music is almost a complete art form. Like it's almost in a way it's almost all been done, like just writing songs for albums. And so I think the question more now is what is music for? Like it's for this whole larger, it's part of something bigger that music is like the most primal thing that we'll always have, but it'll be used in higher and higher complex art forms. And I think he's in that territory and that Instagram account. It's like people say, oh, it's an Instagram account. What are you talking about? Makes videos. No, but he's making like 2-minute videos that incorporate his lifestyle and who he is. And there's music that they write for every Instagram video every week that's special. And it's obviously artistic on all these levels. And of course, the music's on Spotify. You can listen to it, but that's secondary to the primary thing. And I think the future's super wide open for that. So
well, it's the same thing as like you're just seeing all of this, like even with like podcasting, the Midnight Gospel on Netflix, mm-hmm. they're adding music, they're adding animation to it, and you're just getting a whole nother layer. And you're right, I never even thought about that, but how silly is it that you create this music and this album, then you have to pay somebody else to make a video for you about how you're rocking out? You know what I mean? The least thing the song's about is you rocking out on stage, but how many videos have been made about a band rocking out on stage?
Yeah, it's just a bad formula.
We've done them. But you know what I mean? I get it in the beginning, but now it's so overdone that everybody's like, oh, am I going to watch another? Why do I need to watch this? It doesn't speak to me about the song. There's plenty of videos that can.
Like Paranoid Android. That'll work.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
real. That's something, you know, or the Gorillaz when they do stuff. The Gorillaz are the predecessor to Oliver Tree, in my opinion.
Yeah, you might be
right.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah, you might be right. They were creating something, but oftentimes I think artists have just kind of been bulldozed over and said, we got to get a video out because it's important. And then you're like, okay. And we have the next wave of
visual original music that's emotional paired with video primarily, I think it's going to be really powerful. I don't think we're quite there yet, but I think that's where we're headed. Yeah.
All right, next group, The Strokes.
Oh, yes, two of my favorite groups.
Well, this one's interesting because The Strokes say that they're open to the idea of playing their classic albums in full. SNL cast member Colin Jost put the idea into the band during the latest edition of Five Guys Talking About Things They Know Nothing About, which is the band's they do this live, I guess, Zoom call or whatever. I watched one. It was so boring. God, I hope people if you're watching this and thinking how I felt about that, turn it off. Don't ever listen to Emery again, because I was like, I love The Strokes. They're one of my all-time favorite bands.
Yeah.
And it was so bad. I was like, why are they on here? It's just talking. Da, da, da. What'd you say? If I keep watching this, I will hate this band. And I love this band. I can't. But anyway, they went on to talk about this a little bit. And Albert Hammond said, even if that's a short, like 35-minute show, it's a good idea, and that's a cool idea. I think we will steal this idea. But it's funny because I was thinking about that. Oh, The Strokes albums are so short. Like if they like that's kind of neat that they could play their whole album and it really would be a short show. Yeah. You know what I mean? It wouldn't even be that long. But I saw this and it started making me think about a lot of people watching now watched Under Oath do that. Mm-hmm. Play they're doing that yeah. like every Friday night or something like that. They're playing their albums all the way through. And I'm wondering like that seems like it can last for a time, but I don't know. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering what this will look like. Even going back to the Oliver Tree article, we can't just only, that's why we do this. Cause we were like, well, if we just play music, it feels like is that all we are? What, like our band can't operate that way, but I wonder how can it, it's a really neat idea to get bands to play their whole albums all the way through. I love that idea. And that mm-hmm. actually even works online when you do it well. And I'm Under Oath, I'm sure, is doing it super well. Strokes will do it really well too. But I'm wondering how long it can last and what is the thing that's coming? Because like we just said with Oliver Tree, there has to be video and stuff that you care about to go along with the meaning of what you're writing musically. But how do artists survive and how does it morph into a not in-person environment?
Well, that has to change too, because the whole music scene changed in the, you know, mid 2000, like 2008, 2009, you know, that to where, or and beyond, to where albums weren't as significant after that point, right? So from, you know, 2010 till now, you know, that I would say that singles have overtaken albums, right?
Yeah.
For the most part. So eventually, I mean, there'll be really classic albums to where maybe, you know, a band plays their 20-year anniversary, then maybe they play their 30-year anniversary for an album or something like that. But I'm not sure there'll be 10-year anniversaries for albums in the future.
No, I think you know what right. I mean. Like, I think we hit a spot where the industry, it blew up and was great and alive and new, because there wasn't what it was but until it was. And then that next decade, after it was kind of things changed, has been kind of a holding pattern. Like, it's not been great, to be honest, I don't think. It's just, it exists, but it's not the same. So we probably are due for a new explosion of new things that are, that you can't, it's not what Under Oath's doing, it's not this, I mean, it's not that, but it's these are the beginnings of it. That Instagram account, Oliver Tree, and people doing streams and putting out more, you know, pairing it with more things. So we're in that stage, and stuff's going to take off, and everybody will respond, and we'll have a whole new thing, and it'll, of course, be a lot online. But I want to say one thing that might be slightly controversial.
Uh-oh.
Oh,
and
crap.
If I piss anybody off, I don't care. I like Oliver Tree because it's funny. I love Love Shack because it's light, and it really delivers on art. Reggie and the Full Effect is about my favorite band for the same reason, and that's why I like Queen. But let me tell you what I do not like, that I do not think you should confuse with that, is that whatever that kind of bullcrap stuff is that Matty Mullins just did. That's not funny or good, either one. I don't like that. That's not in the same thing, right? No. I don't know how to describe the difference, because it's funny and it sounds good and it's high production. Right. But why do I hate it so much?
I don't know.
It's not right. So yeah, I really don't like it.
For those of you out there that don't know what we're talking about, Matty Mullins has like a some kind of like country gang, or they do like it's country
rap kind of thing.
They don't really rap, but it's like art, country R&B rap type music. I don't know.
I think the difference is that, you know, I mean, we don't really know Matty personally, right? I don't think you guys do either.
I've talked to him a little bit.
I mean, I don't know it. I don't know him at all, really. But I know kind of the type of guy he is. I mean, just based on his, you know, just his persona.
I did have a call with him to have him on the podcast once, and then after I talked to him, I did not move forward with the podcast.
He was on our podcast.
Oh, he was. It was on Break It Down, though. It was before that. It was a time after that or before that I was going to have him on, and I just couldn't get on the same wavelength at all.
But you know what? Okay, so based on our opinion of him, I'm not saying he's bad or good guy. I don't know him.
Yeah, I'm not judging.
But based on his persona, you know what he was doing when he did it.
But what is it? Right? Why does it bother me?
Okay, here's what it is. This is what I really believe about music like that. Oliver Tree is doing something that, even though it is funny or there's humor to it, it is meant to be art and taken pretty far. It feels like the Matty Mullins song is, hey, we know this is silly, but look, we're doing it so well and it's cool. Like the idea is... it's not, it's totally not authentic. and they can say they don't, they can bail on it at any moment. Oliver Tree isn't bailing on it. You know what I mean? Like he's fully in. You could bail on the country rap, like, oh man, that was just a joke. If everybody shit on it or something, you know what I mean? Like you don't, you just can, you can get away from it.
There's
so it's
no
not
skin
real.
In
you don't,
the game.
You
right?
don't. You don't think, man, he loves this, and this is what he cares about.
Yeah,
but if it blew up, he would go. He would say he loves it.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't, but I mean, that's anybody, maybe. I don't
commercial,
think he's
commercial, even though it's funny. Yeah. But it's not about being funny because the best music in the world to me can pull off being funny and own it and really, I you know, that's why I love that kind of music. But for some reason, that bot really drives me nuts.
Devin Davis on Facebook says Oliver Tree takes his music seriously, and he does. That's probably the thing.
Yeah,
it's not. Yeah. It's. Yeah. I mean, he's doing something with humor, but the music is painstakingly put a lot of work and effort into it to create something real, not just a copy of something that might be funny or something. You know what I mean? And maybe that's all they were doing it for. So maybe that's the thing. Maybe Matt and Mullen's band was just. Is a joke band. They're just doing
it's
something
fun.
Just to do
I'm
it.
I'm sure they like it. But, I mean, it's no judgment on
high production.
Way, but
high production.
With like Queen. I mean, Queen is a super serious band,
right?
With super serious people, but they did lighthearted music a lot of times.
Like I Want to Ride My Bicycle.
Right, but and the reason you respect that so much is because they are like they're actually like showmen.
Yeah, it's amazing.
You know what I mean? Like it's like you go to like a real musical, like a show, like an almost like an opera or something, to where you know they're gonna have a good time. You know they're gonna do their dance or whatever, but the music is gonna be incredible. No matter what style it is, no matter what they're doing, it's going to be some of the best stuff you've ever heard. Even though Freddie Mercury is like a total prima donna type guy, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's different too, because you know it's like a showman.
Yeah. Well, Marilyn? Is that somebody says Manson's new album is comedy based? Is that Marilyn Manson? Does he have
is
a new
true?
Album? Because I love Marilyn Manson. But I don't know if he has a new album. But if he does, good.
Well, and of course somebody brought up Weird Al, but that's of course. Hilarious. Yeah. I mean, that's meant to be a joke, and it's unbelievable.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, I don't know about Manson's new album.
You know, I think you're supposed to pair complexity in music, and funny is a really hard one to pull off, and you got to really admire it. But Matty Mullins isn't funny, though.
That's what I'm saying.
Like, he's trying to. Maybe he's trying to break out of it.
Yeah, but I'm just. That's not like. It's the same. You can't. You have to do what is in your character. You can't. Pretend it's like it's just out of character or something.
It's like
know.
If Spencer Chamberlain came out with a comedy
yeah,
album.
Yeah, that's not he's yes exactly.
You wouldn't like it.
It's not a matter of if he comes up with funny stuff. That's not something that he can pull off, and that's not bad. He shouldn't do that. He should do it's just basic. It's something in your core of your personality that you have to stick to be legit or something. I don't know what it is, but anyway.
All right, one more news story. Okay. Old Elon Musk got in trouble this week. His lady is named Grimes, and she's a music artist. But Grimes has publicly asked Elon, this comes from NME too, to turn off his phone after he stirred backlash with a recent tweet writing, "Pronouns suck." Musk took to Twitter to condemn Twitter users with a rose in their handle, which, according to Mashable, is the best representation or symbol of the political group, the Democratic Socialists of America. He wrote, "Rose, Twitter sucks," and Musk wrote before putting a rose in his username. Shortly thereafter, he tweeted, "Pronouns suck." In a now-deleted response, Grimes replied to Musk's latter tweet, asking him to turn off his phone or to give her a call. "I love you, but please turn off your phone or give me a call," she wrote. "I cannot support hate. Please stop this. I know this isn't your heart." While Grimes' reply has been deleted, Musk's original tweet at the time of writing is still public. Elon recently made some headlines because he supported Kanye West for presidential campaign, but then he reconsidered very shortly after and said, kind of pulled back. He said, "We may have more differences of opinion than I anticipated." But Elon Musk is no... he has no fear of tweeting all the stuff, but this is interesting that his wife, they just had a baby, which they named XAEA-X2. I forget, and they might just be calling him X or something, but that's the name of the baby. So he's wild. I love it.
Series of letters.
I just his wildness is just so unpredictable and fun to me that I really appreciate it. But he getting called out by his wife. You know what I mean? You just, I mean, yep. You can't, you know, she did it right in public. Now that's it. All that is weird to me because she has his phone number and could, if he's tweeting, she could have texted him privately. Yeah. So do you think that's,
I never like, trust at any that of stage, that stuff.
They're both famous. That she felt like she had to do that for her.
It's the image, same way that
brand.
It's the same way that if you and your wife are at like a social gathering or something like a party, and you say something maybe that you shouldn't have said, and your wife makes a courtesy laugh.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? She's covering for you. Like
you think that
she's trying to protect you. So I think probably she publicly went out and said, "Honey, listen, no, that's not okay. Let's bring it back in a little bit." So I think that's what she was doing.
Yeah, I think you're
just
right.
Just like
Devin.
That.
I think that's probably right. But he's.
You think
know,
it was that? You think she was protecting him? Like she thought people were going
to
get really mad at
him?
I
think she wanted to look out for herself too.
Right.
But I'm saying in the modern day age with Twitter, I think that's the same way as you might think of you saying something stupid at a party and your wife trying to help you out, cover you up a little bit.
I thought it was the opposite. You know, like when you say something stupid at a party about your wife and then she says, "Oh, really? Oh, that's funny because last week you know," and then you just, "Oh, God."
That could be the case too. Yeah.
Why did I do it? Oh, my. Like, I think he made her mad. He took off. He's at work and he tweeted something. She's like, "Oh, hell no." And, you know, shut that down.
That's
shut
possible.
That shit
man,
down
that's
real
possible.
Quick. So, all right. That's the damn news.
All right.
Hey, y'all get to talking about what we're going to talk about next. I got to go pee pee. I'll be right back.
Okay.
And the damn news.
So much. Tippy newsman. Tippy newsman. All right, we got one more song tonight. And Matt, this is the song you said has gotten you emotional now.
Well, emotional, not sad, though. Like this one, well, it's sad. It's different than sad. That's what I think is neat about I'm Only a Man. And I wanted to talk about that with you and Devin both. I feel like we're getting into this stretch of I'm Only a Man here that really is what makes the album special. And is really sets it apart. So we've got After the Devil Beats His Wife and then Can't Stop the Killer. So that is the album to me. If you had to just take, you know, 8 minutes, 9 minutes of music and you have After the Devil Beats His Wife and Can't Stop the Killer back to back, that to me sums up I'm Only a Man. That's it. That's the album to me.
Yeah.
Like there's a lot of other good stuff on it too, but that is both of those songs are very unique and different from the genre that we were in when we did the question. Right. And then they're just really, really adventurous songs that don't fit whatever genre we were really in, but really worked and got pulled off. And even especially, I think, on these new recordings of them, even better. But neither one, and one of the leaps out of our normal genres, what we're doing, I'm Only a Man, was to do lyrics that were less personal and more story or something like that, which I wasn't thinking that much at the time, but I've thought a lot about it since. And it's like, I really feel strongly that only some people can pull off some things. So if you're going to do a fictional lyrics about a story, it has to be believable from the person singing it. In the same way that Matty Mullins and Spencer couldn't pull off a funny song like James DeWeese can. But he can't, you know, it has to be something rooted in. And I think on both of these two songs, you and Devin found a way to tell a story that sounds like it's from your point of view in a way that is very believable. And it's just astonishingly believable. And now you know the song well, and you have a great vocal take here. So it forced me to, like, you know, deal with it. Like, and listen to the lyrics and see what you were trying to say. And it's like the story didn't happen to you, but it makes me feel bad for you. Like I'm sad for you. Like it's not sad. Like I don't feel sad about me. Like you listen to a song where you put it on yourself. It's a fictional feeling thing, like a scene in a movie that you're like, "Oh my gosh, this is so intense." Like I feel it as emotionally intense and I can visualize it. And you know, like that's the level that, and Can't Stop the Killer is the same way. It's like, we always make a joke. It's not Devin didn't write a song, personal emo lyrics when he once killed his wife or something, but it is believable. And I think it's and we can talk about that one next week, but it seems like, is there a dark side of Devin that has those types of, is there a situation that could arise in which you could actually see yourself in that position? Not that you ever would, but there's a circumstance in which that would be the way you would see it. It's not about some fictional character, somehow still about you. Do you feel that way about this song? And can we talk about the lyrics just for closure for me?
Sure.
How do you write this song? So tell them what it's about if people don't know. But, I mean, just explain it to me.
So this song's called After the Devil Beats His Wife, which is, I think we talked about this maybe last week or on the BC pod, but which is a Southern saying for it, when it's raining and the sun's out, which I think is neat because the two things don't seem to, you can't figure it out or why is it happening? It's strange. It's bizarre. And so I named the song this because that's the situation is created. What has actually happened? This shouldn't be happening. Why would this, everything was fine. And now all of a sudden this weird thing's happening. So I wrote this song. I got this idea for a story in my head about the idea of two people out in a river and one gets caught foot entrapment leg and can't get up, and you're trying to hold them up, and I was thinking the water just rushing over and you're just trying to pull, and every you're there with your friends and they're on the shore because the water's heavy, it's an accident basically that has happened. Maybe I was thinking, you go out to the river and everybody's cutting up a little bit, but the water's a little too high, so everybody just kind of hangs out on the side, but two guys go, I bet I could go to this far or something like that. It's a good day. All of a sudden, something horrific happens where you're like, oh, my God, you could die, and you're just trying to hold this person. And so that's what the song is about. And the idea of it is that someone is dying. And you're doing everything you can to save them, but you just can't. And then it flips into, I decided long ago, never let your loved ones know who you really are, who you really are. People want the truth, but never want the scars. And now I'm here, my best friend dying. And I'm the one that's still lying. And you say it's going to be okay over. And I was just thinking the idea of that is the mix of trying to be the good person and what you present to people. And then the person that's actually dying is saying, hey, it's going to be all right. Don't worry. Like the person that was dying, the guy that I'm trying to save, my friend, is saying, you say it's going to be okay over and over. It's going to be okay, Toby. It's going to be okay. Don't worry. Like trying to let me off the hook because they can see my face that I'm the real me standing there going, oh my God, you're going to die and I cannot help you. And there's nothing. And that even at that moment, there's somebody that would say, it's all right. It's not all on you. There's a little bit of Jesus Savior thought there too, that, how much you take on your shoulders and how much you can live with or whatever. So I know I'm not making total sense here, but
but that's real for you in some way, that the feelings of that are real. It just happens to be set with the person drowning or something, but those must be real feelings that you have or experience. But the situation isn't, but it seems like, you identify with the person saving the person you identify with the person drowning that's still feeling bad for other people.
I think In this song, when I wrote this, I was the person trying to save somebody.
Uh-huh.
And that kind of conveys the image of wanting to be the good person, wanting to be the person that is there for everybody. And then when you can't even handle it. And the person that you're trying to help actually has to be the hero and go, it's okay.
Yes. Yeah.
It's okay.
But that's so dramatic. I mean, it's just so dramatic. Like it should be a scene in Stand By Me or something.
Something like that. I agree. It is like that. That's what I'm saying. The imagery here is a nice day. All of a sudden, shit, my friend might die. He's not going to die. Come on. I can do it. Oh, everybody, it's all right. I can do it. I can go out in the water and save him. I can do it. Look at me. And then you can't. And then you immediately realize all your weaknesses, all your failures, all of this stuff. And you can't do anything, and then that person has to become the person dying is actually the hero, not you, and you never were.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Well.
And then we talked about this too, that actually happened to my dad. Remember?
Yeah, that was what was so weird.
My dad tried to save his friend, and then he couldn't save him. Couldn't
pull after
him up.
I wrote the song, Devin told me that. I was like, this is what's in Devin's like, yeah, but that actually happened to Devin's father.
He was younger or what?
Yeah, when he was I think he told me he was 17 or 18. Him and his buddy went swimming. And, just being teenagers, like Toby's saying, on a good day. And his foot got stuck. Couldn't pull him up. He drowned.
The water just rushes over you, and that's it.
Yes.
Yep. There's an old 70s movie where this is a scene in the movie. It stuck with me forever. See if I can find it while we're doing that. But foot entrapment in a movie. Google. We'll see if that shows up.
I'm sure it's in more than one, probably. But that, I mean, still. So when I'm coming to it, trying to make the recording this week, and it's just this, it's a lot easier now because I feel like the, you know, there's imagery in the production and then the parts and the playing and the whole end there when it's just waves coming over of that guitar riff over and over. I feel like that's just waves coming and crashing and it's chaos. And so, I mean, this is the simplest little thing to my level. Before it was just notes and a guitar solo and a drum solo. But now, this time when I was putting together, I felt more like I used two different kind of leads on it. I used a piano sound and a guitar sound, and I was just making it where you can't ever feel settled. Like, you can't ever really rest in it. Like, you can't ever tell which is the melody. So it's almost the opposite of being catchy and melodic, but it's like you can't decide what to focus on, basically.
Yeah.
In the chaos,
right.
Basically.
Yeah.
So instead of having a guitar lead, you could do a cool solo here, but that would be dumb. There's a guitar solo in it, but at the end, and it's over and over and over, and then it's just rushing over, and it's really hard to tell what to pay attention to, and it's just chaotic until it ends, and it goes on longer than the time swells, and you feel like it can't. Is the song ever going to end? What's going to happen?
Right.
So all that inside of the, it was really fun for me to get to produce the song with the full, really being plugged into it. But I thought your vocal take was terrific on this. Like it's really good. It really is a good take. And it was a whole take pretty much too. I think you did two takes, but
I did one take, where I tried to be as close as I could to the original, and then I did one more, a little bit more experimental, just to see. But it turned out, I'm pretty happy with the vocals.
I love it. I just did the mix this morning, and it's more of a rough mix. I'm trying some different stuff, so this is certainly not final mix, but I think it sounds really good, and I don't know how to explain it really, but this, I think that this song feels like, I don't know. I don't even know what to say about it, but I really have enjoyed working on it. And there's another really cool production note that we didn't quite get everything pulled off I wanted to do, but we'll probably update it. But one of our listeners, Ben Loves Lamp, is his name in Discord, sent in the mandolin part.
Nice.
But I don't have a video.
That's awesome.
I asked him if he had a video, so you're not going to get to see him play it. But I'll look and see if he didn't send one still, but I asked him in Discord. So if he's here and wants to send a video, I will update it. Eventually, and I think it'll be the final mandolin part. It's not exactly like it is on the original, but I think it's cool. It totally worked out. So
I loved it.
Sounds good.
Yeah, if y'all didn't notice, then that's great. And then I had a couple other people send in. Oh man, he did send it. I'm gonna see if I can't get it. I can't get it edited in the video, but I'll try and see if I can download it and show y'all in a second. Let's see if I can do that. How can I? Oh, it's a screenshot. Okay, so we'll get that next week and update it, and I'll show you that because I would have loved to have it unveiled today with him actually playing the mandolin part. But it sounded great. He played well. His timing was really good. So good job, Ben. Thank you for contributing to that. And we'll look for some other spots for people to contribute, But I love the idea that an Emory fan in Emory land is going to be on this
new me too.
Recording. So
that's already two songs we got fans on. So that's cool.
And there's more opportunities too for both gang vocals and there's other stuff that we can get for sure. So let's not forget that the pre-order is up for this right now. It's you can order this vinyl on pre-order now at emorymusic.com, and that's been a big deal. We sold a ton already, and so I was worried before it came if people are like, oh no, well, we don't want that because it's not the original recording or whatever, but we're selling a tremendous amount of these, so that's good news that you're liking what we're doing and you understand what it is and appreciate the recording. And we have like new life to this album, and I feel very alive creating it. So what else about the song? Anything else to notice for people you want them to pay attention to? Or
I really love Devin's harmony on
over and over.
Devin sings a harmony part there that's just, I loved it.
We've been trying to do basically the exact same things that we did on the original, but there's a few things I think we both have this throughout the album that I wish I would have done. After you hear songs, you're like, man, I could have done a good harmony there. That was one of the parts I was like, I think I could do something here without overtaking the main part.
I love
so
it.
I'm glad you guys like it.
Let's play it.
The video has a few things that are off because there's a few, I think we did a couple of different drum takes on the end for Dave, and then some of the stuff I played in the take that I recorded maybe doesn't perfectly match. So there might be some sloppier things in the videos, but this is pretty close to it at least. And the energy of the take and everything's great. I haven't watched the video yet. We just sent them all in, and I just downloaded it. So I haven't even seen this video put together at all. So I haven't even seen y'all's performance on video or anything. But I'm excited. Go pre-order this on vinyl. It means a lot. It's the project we're working on right now. And, go ahead and tip here. But if you want to spend your money buying I'm Only a Man vinyl, that would mean a lot to us. And we got a lot of tippers. We've had it be wild since we've got that. So do we want to go ahead and update that? Because we'll be done after this. So
As of right now, I can give one more update after the song. But right now, Carolyn Addy is top. And Derek Durst is second. So those are the top two right now. Everybody's tipping a lot. So thank you guys
very much.
Another
500 bits from Ayalamoto. So
watch out. It's coming on strong.
And how much is the amount that is that it's at right now, so people know?
$100 is the top.
Oh, so somebody's already paid full face value for one.
Somebody's
of them.
Carolyn already did, and Derek said about 62. So thank you guys very much.
It's still a discount between 62 and 100 if anybody wants to get it. Or if you just love this song, you could just make it rain. All right. you get the pardon the pun on make it rain.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. All right, here we go. After the devil beats his wife, it is at this time for sure my favorite Emery song on I'm Only a Man, maybe my favorite Emery song.
You want to swim in the river, I want to dance in the summer. You've always been the believer, I'm always left to wonder. The water's rushing so fast, I think it will take us under.
Can't beat that.
Wow.
Can't beat it.
Not at all.
Turned out good.
It turned out lovely.
Yeah.
I love that.
So, yeah, that's great. Great job, Matt.
Yeah, thank you. I enjoyed that one very much. And this next week was a song we played live so much, Can't Stop the Killer, that it's going to be a breeze. That one was a challenge to figure out how to get just to channel it correctly, get the energy back. So this one, this week, was I was laser beamed. Whenever I was upstairs or hanging out with the kids, I was thinking, got to get back to that song. I got, because all the piano parts and the mandolin and the everything about it, I was all week, I was in just this. I'm on it. This, you know, I couldn't wait to get back down here to finish it. So I had a blast. But next week, I bet I could knock this one out fast. You can't stop the killer. I know everything about it, in and out, so many ways. I'm looking forward to doing it quickly. So thank you guys. I hope y'all enjoyed that very much. Any good notes or?
Oh yeah, I mean,
people say,
several people said they thought this is the best re-recording so far. Just all good stuff. So thank you guys very much.
Recording this one made me think back to, like, man, this song is really neat. Like, it is really fun. Like, it was fun to even sing it again, and I liked the parts, and it felt good to do. So I just really enjoyed this one a lot. I mean, I said this the other day, Devin. Overall, it was a little daunting doing this again. I was like, we're just going to sing this again, and what's that going to be like? But it's really been fun singing these songs.
Yeah, I know.
Like, man, I don't know how fun it is for you playing, because I know
so
it's a lot
fun.
On you. But
it's the
best. I have really enjoyed it.
I got something. Hang on a second. I want to show you one more. I got one little video. Let's see if I got one little video I want to show you. I did. There's this keyboard part that I wanted to show. Let's see if I've got this here.
Oh, that was another thing too, Matt. I really like the piano in this one, like especially the kind of dissonant right before the end. That's some good stuff. I like that a lot.
It just kind of came out. I didn't overthink it. I just kind of jam and let it, you know, just let it come out, and then don't spend too long. I don't have time to spend, you know, so I just have to get there. Like, the pressure of doing the show, I just want to say thank you so much to the fans that are here. So there's a reason that I have pressure to, like, I have to play now, and whatever comes out, I have to just, you know, it's kind of like I think we all do when you do those one takes. It's like, I have to be whatever I want to be here, and it just has to come out and do it. So I do everything pretty quickly instead of overthinking it. It's just makes me feel so good. But the keyboard thing, I'm going to pull this clip up, because I did the keyboard. I thought the gear heads and the pedal heads might want to see something. So talk for a second. Let me pull this up.
Yeah, I think the thing about it too is we don't play live much. You know what I mean? Like, over the years, we haven't played it much. So kind of it feels a little bit like getting to perform it. Because I know we're doing it for the videos and stuff too, but it really feels kind of fun to get to perform these songs. So that part's really neat. And then overall, I think it is going to sound really good. Like, so far, I've just been really happy with the way this record's turning out. I mean, it's a record that's over a decade old, a few years over a decade old, and here it is back, and it feels fun and fresh. And I guess I'll say this: I look back on it. Obviously, we thought this record was going to take us to the moon when it came out, but I look back on it and really love these songs. I'm just happy. Like, I always felt like I love this album, and then redoing this album now, I just really do love the songs. Like, every single one that we've done, I'm like, this is such a good song. I mean, World Away. Yeah. I was like, good Lord, what a hilariously amazing song to do for an emo band, a screamo band in 2008.
The
balls to do that. I like those kids, man. Those 2008 Emory dudes are pretty fucking cool, man.
Yeah.
Seriously. Like, I mean, what were they? I mean, we didn't just do the question two. We really didn't. So, I mean, it didn't work out financially the way we wanted, but overall, it probably made us better people and better musicians. So, I'm digging it.
I thought that was a pretty illustrative of a cool track order to go from World Away to After the Devil there. Like, that's a head swivel or kind of a thing.
I know.
I'm not able to get this clip up, so we'll just have to skip it. But I got a clip of the pedals that I put on this keyboard sound at the end, that's the duels with the guitar, and it's just... It's really fun, and I thought people would dig it, but I will have to put it in Emory Land. So if you want to join Emory Land... You can do that. I believe if they buy a certain amount of stuff, they get Emory Land trial. You join Emory Land just by buying a vinyl, I think, right?
Maybe. I mean, I know there's a certain amount you spend, or something. But yeah, you should get an email right away saying you've qualified for a free trial. Is that right?
Yeah, I think you at least get 3 months just by buying. I'm only a man. But if you get coming to Emery Land, there's a bunch of stuff. We have other assets.
Yeah, we've already given the first three songs as a little EP download kind of thing. So we'll be giving those out incrementally throughout this process.
Yes. So do that. Join it. Come on in. And there'll be, more stuff.
Yep.
I'll put the clip in there in the Discord tonight for everybody or that's interested in gear, pedals, and that kind of shit.
All right. I got the final tipper count, I think. I don't think Reva's going to send another one. So the winner coming from behind is like a horse race. Mm-hmm. Coming from behind, R.C. Evans 80 came up.
Wow.
And passed Carolyn on that last home stretch.
Wow.
So R.C. Evans and Carolyn got the top two. So we'll be in touch with you guys through email, and we'll figure out what all we're going to send you. But you'll get a lot of goodies in the next week or so.
Yes.
And Reva, just remind us, any pre-order qualifies for a three-month trial.
Yes.
You get 3 months for any pre-order, right?
Any pre-order,
you don't even have to say trial. You just say 3 months.
Three months.
In Emeryland. It's not like you get
full membership for that period of time.
You're in there,
That way you'll get at least understand what's going on. But that's just if you buy the cheapest vinyl or anything. And we love it so much that we get to sell this vinyl. We didn't have to go through EMI, Universal Music Group, or anything. It's just we're making these new recordings. We love them. We get to sell them. And it's all in-house. Those records that they license from Tooth & Nail has to license from that other. They wind up having to spend, I think they wind up having like, don't quote me on this, but I'm not going to say, but it's a crazy amount that you have to pay in licensing fees to those labels to get those vinyls just to reissue them. You don't make any money at all. But this we actually will make a little bit of money on, so we do really appreciate it. I know money's tight for people. But Black Vinyl, Emeryland membership, tips tonight. Couldn't be happier. So thank you guys all.
Awesome.
Thank you guys.
All right. We headed over to Twitch. Sticking with Twitch, right? And doing a little after show.
Yeah, we can for a few minutes. I got to go. Actually, go pick up some Indian food that I just put in.
Oh, wow.
Rip Bridget.
Oh, very nice.
But no, we're not. But I can't drop off of Facebook. So we'll just wrap it up here.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, we don't have to do.
Well, I found the movie. It's really neat because I thought it had Paul Newman in it. And I was right. So it's Paul Newman and Henry Fonda in this movie, and it's called Sometimes a Great Notion. And at the end of that movie, it ends up being and this is why this is really neat. I had forgotten about this. I don't want to. I mean, whoever wants to watch it, spoiler alert. But one of the guys, Henry Fonda, a log falls on him. And it's just an accident, and he's just laughing. He's just kind of peeing, but no danger. He's not hurt. It's just he can't get out from under it, But it rolls with the water, and then he's actually trapped and going to die.
Wow.
So it was just like a oh man, I can't believe I got caught here with this stupid log. Everything, but it when it rolled, then the water started. It created like a dam situation. Started going.